Let's pray. Jesus, you defeated darkness. Jesus, the Messiah, rose again. We come this morning together to acknowledge the risen Christ, to see him in our lives and those lives who have been transformed by his grace. We've not seen Jesus face to face, but we have seen him in the faces of everyone who loves and encourages us. We've not touched the wounds from the cross, but we've been called to bring healing to the scarred world. So, Father, this morning we praise the risen Christ to stand amongst us wherever we are today. Lord Jesus, we welcome you into our hearts, into our minds, into our worship, and be with us now as we join together as one church. Amen. Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to St. Catherine's and St. Andrew's Online this morning. Before we start this morning, I would like just to take a moment this week as we remember His Royal Highness, the Duke of Edinburgh. So I've got a prayer coming up, but let's just take a moment first before we start. Let's just take a moment just to remember His Royal Highness. And we say together, God of our lives, we give thanks for the life of Prince Philip, for his love of our country, and for his devotion to duty. We entrust him now to your love and mercy through our Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you and also with you. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. We're going to have our first song this morning, Blessed Be Your Name, with Matt Redman.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I turn back to praise. When the dark closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name.
Yes, sir. the darkness closes in, Lord, still I'm gonna say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, Jesus, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen. We're going to come to a time of confession. And let's just take a moment just before we come to the God with our problems that are troubling us on our hearts this morning. So when we keep our faults and failures locked safely away, we have no need to confess. But God comes into our hearts when we least expect, so we can be filled with forgiveness, with hope, and with peace. So let's join together as we say, God of empty tombs and empty people, when we hesitate to speak of your hope, forgive us and give us voice. When we find it difficult to love each other, forgive us and give us new compassion. When we want to stand with the high and mighty, forgive us and put us next to the poor and oppressed. When we stay locked behind our fears and doubts, forgive us and send us out to share your grace. When we cannot believe your word of new life, forgive us and fill us with your joy. Just take a moment just to lift up to God anything heavy on your heart this morning. So, brothers and sisters, Christ comes into every shadow corner of our lives with the light of Easter. Christ comes into the locked rooms of our faults and gives us with grace and hope. Christ comes to fill us with peace that we may proclaim the good news of mercy and forgiveness. Thanks be to God, Christ has come to us. Amen. And as forgiven people, we're going to have our affirmation of faith. So do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one from whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And we're going to continue the affirmation of faith with an incredible song by Hillsong, I Believe. Thank you. It's incredible. This morning we're going to talk about Jesus coming to the disciples in the upper room. And that same Jesus is here in this room today, is with you in your homes at home. And just pray, Jesus, pray that Holy Spirit into your life and into every part of your life and everything you do. Because he's risen. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. We're going to come to the collect. So the collect for this morning. Risen Christ, for whom no door is locked, no entrance barred, open the door of our hearts, that we may seek the good of others and walk the joyful road of sacrifice and peace to the praise of God the Father. Amen. And our reading this morning is taken from John 20, 19 to 31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hands into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your fingers here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because of you have seen me, you have believed, and you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everyone. Let's just pray for a moment. Lord our God, may I speak in the name of the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. When I heard the news of the death of Prince Philip on Friday, I wondered seriously if I needed to prepare a different sermon. And although I have made some amendments to what I originally wrote, I decided that the message of Easter and Jesus' resurrection is indeed appropriate to the situation that we find ourselves in. Because it's in those times of grief and sadness that we need to hold on to that message of hope that's at the very heart of Easter. That hope that tells us that although death is inevitable, the good news is that Jesus has won the victory over sin and evil and over death itself. With Jesus' resurrection appearances giving his followers, both past and present, assurance that death is not the end of their story, just as it wasn't the end of the Jesus story. And when we read the Gospels, we see that each of the writers give a different picture of those resurrection appearances, writing about different places where they encountered the resurrected Christ, from the road to Emmaus, to an upper room, and even to the beach. And I don't think that the fact that the gospel writers give us different accounts is a problem. Perhaps it's only to be expected, as different people share their own aspect of the events. But even with those differences, they all have an important factor in common. And that important factor is the fact that the disciples were transformed by meeting with the resurrected Christ. You see, they were living with the reality that Jesus' death was the end of his story and the end of their hopes of freedom from the foreign occupation. However, in his resurrection stories, we see Jesus helping them to rethink and reshape that reality, so that rather than the events of Easter ending with disappointment and defeat, the story continues, maybe not in the way that was anticipated with the victory over earthly powers, which inflict oppression, injustice, suffering, and pain, but victory over injustice, suffering, and pain themselves. Together with the resurrection demonstrating Jesus' death, victory over death, together with that promise of the new hope, new creation, new life, and the establishment of God's kingdom, so that what seemed to be the end actually became a new beginning. With the death on Good Friday being transformed to new life on Easter Sunday, and disappointment is transformed to something new and seemingly unexpected. And the disciples themselves too are transformed through their encounter with the resurrected Jesus, beginning with the women at the empty tomb, spreading to the 11 disciples and to many, many more. And step by step, we see those first followers of Jesus undergoing a transformation which comes from seeing the story differently and seeing that death was not the end. So defeat turns to victory, ignorance turns to understanding, doubt turns to faith, despair turns to hope, fear turns to confidence, regret and guilt turns to forgiveness and a new commission. This morning we've heard John's account with Jesus appearing to the followers when they were all together, all that is, except Thomas. And so we have that initial account of his doubts and his journey to faith. And if we'd have continued to read on, we'd have read about Jesus' visit to the fishermen and the miraculous catch of fish, with Peter's story being rewritten. Remember, he denied Jesus on Good Friday, but here he is, reinstated and commissioned to be the rock on which God's church would be built. And as those earlier followers began to see things differently, they received new life and a new purpose. These frail individuals are transformed into something different as they receive the Holy Spirit, which is God's breath of life. They're born again as they follow Jesus in becoming part of God's new creation, which came into birth through the pain and suffering of the cross and the resurrection. And Easter's not just a rewriting of our story as human beings, it's a rewriting of the creation story, with God's purposes being to make all things new. This is not about God scrapping the world as we know it and starting again. It's about making all things new. Have you connected that when Mary encountered the resurrected Christ, she's in the garden? She mistakes him for the gardener. And it takes us back to the original creation story back in Genesis, where God creates a garden where plants grow and animals live in peace. And he breathes life into the humans and he gives them a commission to be stewards of his creation, to look after all that he has made. And we know that things go wrong and the harmony is shattered. The soil loses its fertility. Animals become enemies of one another and of humankind. And humanity becomes self-seeking, greedy, confrontational, violent, and unfaithful to God and his creation. The victory of the cross makes a way for the harmony and the peace to be a reality again, as his plan to make all things new come into being through the resurrection, which reshapes the story with the evidence that Jesus has overcome all that is evil and that he is Lord over all things, and therefore his kingdom will overcome the powers that cause injustice. And as Jesus has achieved this victory over sin and death, he commissions his followers then and now to work to grow God's kingdom on earth in order that all things may be transformed, albeit little by little, as the injustice and pain it brings continues to be defeated, yes, through the cross, but it's also pushed back through the words and actions and attitudes of God's people, who are empowered by the Holy Spirit so that justice, peace, and love of God's kingdom can grow and increase. One of the things that has been emphasized about Prince Philip is that he was a man of faith. And I have to admit, I've not listened or watched the wall-to-wall coverage, but some of the things that I've read and I have heard seem to point towards him doing those things that brought positive transformation into the lives of others in his caring for God's world and his people. And it's been moving to hear stories from the young and the not so young of the life-transforming experience they've had through the Duke of Edinburgh Awards, which, to quote Archbishop Stephen Cottrell, has allowed countless young people to develop and discover skills which have instilled confidence in them and given them an encounter of working together for the common good. That's kingdom stuff. Then there have been more moving words from the Jewish leaders, with the UK's chief rabbi commenting in Prince Philip's interaction with affection for the Jewish community. And so we see a demonstration of love towards a nation which has suffered injustice throughout history. Isn't that what Jesus would have done? And together with the tributes from the Jewish community, there have been messages from leaders of other faiths and many other nations, maybe reflecting the prince's willingness to be open to all, irrespective of their backgrounds. He certainly takes a similar stance to the Queen, who once said, "For me, as a Christian, when Jesus answered the question, 'Who is my neighbour?' the implications drawn by Jesus is clearly everyone is our neighbour, no matter what creed, race, or colour." There's also been tributes paid to his passion to conserve the created world, with Archbishop Justin Welby stating that he brought people from around the world to a new concern and commitment to action for the future of our planet. These are all aspects of growing God's kingdom. And are they not an example of somebody responding to the responsibility that God gave to all of humankind to be stewards of creation? And that responsibility that Jesus commissions his followers then and now to participate in, making all things new. And he gives them the power to do it and the authority to make it happen, because we can't do these things in our own power. So Jesus breathes on those early followers and so empowers them with the Holy Spirit. And again, there are echoes of God in the garden at the beginning of time, breathing life into the first man and woman. And with the power of his Spirit, Jesus' followers are enabled to implement God's plan, which had been achieved through Jesus' birth, life, death, and resurrection, and which opened up the way of salvation to all of creation and every nation. And so for those early followers, the story is transformed from one of defeat to one of victory. And they too are transformed from people of fear and despair to people of courage with a purpose as they go out to proclaim the victory that Jesus has won over the powers and principalities of the world in order that his kingdom of love, justice, and peace may come on earth as it is in heaven. And yes, this involved them speaking about Jesus, telling people of the things that he did and said, the things that they had experienced. But it was also about them reflecting his actions and his attitudes in the world, which marked them out as people of the new creation, and which in turn made God's kingdom present on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus' plan and purpose of transformation and making all things new is not something that we, as his followers today, can keep in the past or indeed push into the future. It is something that has to be central to all of us throughout the ages. Each one of us, when we say yes to become Jesus' followers, becomes transformed, made new. That's what baptism symbolizes. As we die to self, all is made new. We proclaim Jesus is Lord of our lives. And as Paul says, it's no longer I that lives, but Christ that lives in me. And that means that our story is reshaped and rewritten. Because with our new creation comes new boldness, a new hope, changed priorities, and a new way of seeing the world and its people. With that fresh awareness that we are called with the power of the Holy Spirit to participate in working towards that new creation in the here and the now. And we need to follow Jesus' example of living in love with God and one another and looking seriously as to how we can live to bring creation back to how God intended, including seeking to promote attitudes where all created things are valued and have the things that they need to flourish. But all too often it seems that we are called to live as Easter people, full of hope for a new creation and looking for signs of that new creation. And when we look around, it seems that we're living in a Good Friday world, full of pain and suffering. These are what I believe are the birth pangs of that new creation. And we must hold on to the promise of the resurrection and to have faith that God is good all the time and that he is faithful, and whatever he has promised, he will do. But it might be useful just to look at Thomas for a moment, because those resurrection appearances certainly had an impact, and perhaps none more than in the case of Thomas. It's that story that's so well known, with poor Thomas being known as Doubting Thomas, even amongst those outside our churches. But I wonder if any of the others would have reacted any differently if they had been absent at Jesus' first visit. But I do think that Thomas can be an encouragement for us as we go about trying to be obedient to Jesus' call of being that Easter people, people of a new creation, living as kingdom builders. You see, Thomas may have doubted, but he was willing to enter into conversation, first with the other disciples, then with Jesus himself. And in those conversations, he was willing to be honest about his doubts. He was willing to ask questions. He was willing to move on, to be transformed and to be made new. Maybe the question for us is, are we that willing to be honest about our doubts, our fears, and our disillusionment? Or do they make us feel guilty and unworthy? Are we willing to have those conversations with others and with Jesus himself? Because questions often get answers. Questions might help us to see a new aspect of the story and gain fresh understanding. And if nothing else, questions might help us to realize that we might never fully understand until we meet Jesus face to face. And we just need to trust him. And yes, we might be tempted to say, that it was different for those first followers. They actually saw the risen Christ. Thomas saw the resurrected Jesus and his wounds. While some of us will have, and as some of us might have accounted Jesus in dreams and visions, many have not. And so we need to listen to those words of Jesus to Thomas that assure us that those who have not actually seen him and still believe will receive blessing. Thomas, despite his doubts, was transformed and went on to spread the good news of Jesus. So what about our calling to be alongside others, to help them to understand their own life story, maybe helping them to see things differently and become part of God's new creation? Are we willing to participate in sharing the message of God's kingdom by sharing the transforming power of Jesus with them? By telling them all that Jesus did and continues to do, alongside telling our own story of how Jesus has transformed our own lives, and helping them to understand that injustice, suffering, and pain have been defeated, and there is hope of life beyond death, and that we believe in a God who is in the business of making all things new. These are messages that are always important. Perhaps something that comes into focus more when we're faced with grief and death, either personally or through the death of a public figure who's had a great deal of influence. And of course, we've all had our own experience of suffering over the last 12 months, where many will have become disillusioned as they've either experienced firsthand or heard of others who have suffered in various ways, including the current pandemic. As God's followers today, are we willing to look for those opportunities to share our message of hope and help others reshape their stories of despair into stories of hope and healing in the situations we find ourselves in today? Now, I doubt whether Prince Philip realized how many lives he actually touched and influenced in such positive ways. And likewise, we might not be aware of things in our lives that are signs of us living in the light of the resurrection, things that have the power to transform, things that that have the power to reshape our story, to turn despair into hope, defeat into victory, grief into joy, things that we can share with others to help them reshape their stories. And I just want to finish by reading something that I was sent last week, and I read it on Monday, but it illustrates how things we choose to do can transform not only our world and our lives, but the lives of others and the life of the whole world. Little things, little attitudes that we have and display that can bring the transforming power of the resurrection and can bring light out of darkness, life out of death. Each time we love again, after having our love rejected, we share in the power of the resurrection. Each time we trust again, after having our trust betrayed, we share in the power of the resurrection. Each time we fail and try again, we share in the power of the resurrection. Each time we hope, after having our hope smashed to pieces, each time we pick up the pieces, wipe our tears, face the sun, and start again, we share in the power of the resurrection. The message of Easter is that nothing can destroy us anymore. Not pain, not sorrow, not sin, not rejection, not even death itself. The message of Easter is that Christ has conquered all and that we too can conquer all if we unite ourselves with him. This is the good news, that we don't have to wait until death to share in the resurrection. We can do it right now, in this life, and in this moment. We're just going to listen to some music now, and I'd invite you either to sing along with it or just use it as a time of stilling, of thanking God for the transformation that you have received having become a follower of Jesus. It's Matt Redman, Benediction.
give us his peace. Give us his peace. Go now in peace. Go now in peace.
Let us pray. As we continue with our Easter celebrations, we do so with the knowledge that the risen Christ is here among us, in this church, in each of our homes, and in each of our hearts, wherever we are and whatever we are doing. Let us now pray in his name for his church and his world. Father, we pray for your blessing on every group of Christians around the world, in every town, village, city and hamlet, for those who worship you in churches, people's homes, grand cathedrals, humble halls or secret rooms, or have nowhere to worship you at all. We thank you for the faith which brings us all together in your name, for the faith which shapes our lives and makes us who we are, for the faith which marks us out as Christians in this your world. Lord, protect and reinforce our faith in you, that we may be like the first apostles in declaring our faith and building your church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, we have not seen you, yet we believe, and others doubt. By our actions in this world, through our prayers and our love of all people, may we help people who, like Thomas, questioned your resurrection. We acknowledge the honesty of Thomas's doubts, and we recognize his dilemma in stating his uncertainty. And now we celebrate his recognition of you, the risen Lord who stood before him as he declared the words, "My Lord and my God." Strengthen our faith, Lord, in always being able to make the same declaration, but without having seen you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for all in positions of leadership throughout the world, whose decisions affect the well-being and safety of their nation's populations, as well as those of the neighboring countries. We pray that you will bless all leaders with discernment and a desire for peace and prosperity, and that the nations may share resources and knowledge for the benefit of all people. Lord, we continue to pray for peace in your world. We bring before you all areas of the world where there is violence, where nations are at war with their neighbors, where populations and communities are divided and at war with each other. In all communities where people live with violence and fear every day. Lord, we pray for the innocent victims of war and indiscriminate violence. We give thanks for the work of people and organizations who offer help, sanctuary, and resources for everyone fleeing or living in dangerous places and situations. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we thank you for the people who lead this, our church, all churches, and leaders of all denominations. May they be united in building your world church to reflect your glory, to share your word, and to care for all in need. May the words and actions of the church be heard, seen, and acknowledged by our rulers as the only true way to bring peace and unity into our divided world. Lord, as the church is forced to re-examine its role in society due to falling numbers of worshippers and income, we pray for those whose considerations will affect the future of all our churches. Lord, may their decisions be spirit-led. May they see your will and our need for your church above all other considerations. Lord, we seek guidance and inspiration from you as our church is to prepare to reopen in safe and worshipful ways. We thank you, Lord, for the innovative ways in which churches and congregations have engaged with each other and in online acts of worship during the lockdowns. And we give thanks for the dedication and skills of all the people who have made this possible. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we give thanks for all the work and dedication of the scientists, all the medical staff and politicians who have guided us through the pandemic. We pray for those who are still ill, for those caring for them, and the friends and families who love them. We pray especially for everyone who have lost friends and family to the virus. Bless them with your peace, Lord, your strength and understanding. And as our lockdowns are gradually lifted, we pray for continued caution and guidance as we resume our pre-lockdown lives, that we and everyone remain safe to avoid a further outbreak. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for all who we know and all who we read about or hear about who are in need of our prayer, support and help. For all who face persecution, for the poor, the weak and the rejected, for those who are ill, for the lonely and the forgotten members of our society, for all who are struggling with the implications of the pandemic and the lockdowns. Lord, bless all these people. Give them strength and reassurance. May they find hope and help in finding you. Enable each of us, Lord, by the power of your Spirit, to bring help and comfort to all these people in need of help. We pray for those who mourn the loss of loved ones. We ask you, Lord, to bring them comfort and hope. And we pray in silence for people we know personally who are in need of our prayers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we give thanks for the life of Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh. for his lifelong dedication to the service of this country in his role as consort to the Queen. We thank you for the inspiration and opportunities he offered to so many people throughout his patronage and active input into so many charitable organisations. We thank you for his Christian faith. And may his unswerving dedication and commitment to his roles as consort, husband, father, grandfather and mentor, friend and influencer, be an inspirational role model to all who seek to emulate him. And we pray for all those who mourn him today and in the future, especially for Her Majesty the Queen, for all of his close and wider family, his many friends, and every ordinary person in this country who feel that they also have lost a good friend. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, with joy in our hearts, we thank you for the new life opened up to each and every one of us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Merciful Father, accept these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now, rejoicing in God's new creation, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Charles. I must admit, it's nice to have Charles back this morning. It's like there's a sense of formality on the horizon as we gather back together. As we come to Norse, talking about gathering back together, next week, St. Catherine's, it's the 18th, St. Catherine's will be open for worship. We'll still continue to stream online. The service will start at 10:30. You need to gather outside. We'll probably open the doors maybe 10-15 minutes before the service. We will be social distancing. We will still have to wear masks, and we'll have to adhere to our risk assessment and local and government rules as well. But it'll be great to come back and just worship together. But if you can't be here, do join us online. That'll continue as normal. Which brings us to APCM. We've got St. Andrew's APCM this coming Tuesday, the 13th of April. If you need a Zoom link for that, contact David or Cathy or myself. I'm sure we can get a link to you. Do try and come on to APCMs. They're important. And after such a strange year, it's going to be interesting to just see what direction the church has possibly been in, but what direction it will be going in as well. St. Catherine's APCM will be on the 22nd of April, and that again will be on Zoom, but we'll give that notice out again nearer the date. I don't think there's any other notices. So as we come to our blessing this morning, so may you trust in God's promise to his people, peace, security, blessing, even when they are difficult to believe. May you know that good news is good news, nourishing, true, even when people tell you that it's not. And when you encounter doubt, may you strengthen your belief, guiding you in his perfect wisdom and counsel. So, brothers and sisters, go in peace, and the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you and those you love today and always. Amen. Thank you for joining us this morning.